one of the leading Christian philosophers in the world is here with us, and we've been talking about the conflict developing in America, in Europe, and in other parts of the world between the forces of atheism, humanism, in some instances it comes out as communism or socialism, in other instances it comes out as what is called humanism or secular humanism, versus the Christian worldview. Two apparently irreconcilable forces that are moving towards some point of a collision in the future. And it's a great pleasure to have with us Dr. Francis Schaeffer. So once again, we welcome him from La Brie Fellowship in Switzerland. Again, God bless you. Schaeffer, we've been talking about this matter of a humanistic worldview and a human society. You mentioned a couple days ago that if we imposed humanism on our form of government, we'd have chaos. Have the humanists ever established a successful society anywhere?
Well, it always runs like this. It's an absolute rule. And that is, first of all, their views, because they're relativistic and they have no base, always leads toward chaos. Just what we're seeing now. Mm-hmm. Now, society cannot stand chaos. I think that's because we're made in the image of God. Mm-hmm. And that, whether we're Christian or not. And therefore, society never can stand chaos. So then there's always the next step, and we see it coming in this country. And the next step is always some form of authoritarian government to contain the chaos. So it always goes through the steps, chaos leading to some form of authoritarian government. You can look back into the Roman Empire, see the rise of Caesar, Caesar Augustus, the worship of Caesar. You can look at the communist countries and their terrible oppression, like the most recent thing in Poland. I wear my
solidarity pin
sent to me by a lovely Christian girl just 2 days before the crackdown in Poland. I hope to wear it, incidentally, till she can wear it again. That's my hope. But you see it in the communistic countries and their form, but wherever you turn, humanism, because it's relativistic, will always lead toward chaos, and the chaos will always bring in some form of totalitarian or authoritarian government.
Well, in other words, you'll see the same thing here, I guess, that if we continue. What you're saying is that humanism cannot contain a society, and to have a self-governing people, they have to be motivated by an inner moral force that deals with a God-given natural law or God law that will control them from within.
What you need is the realization, mm-hmm. Realization that there is a lawgiver. Yeah. Now, that's what our founding fathers built everything on, that there was a creator who was the lawgiver. So we write certain inalienable rights. Right. This is meaningless if the state gives them, or if man gives them, because then he could take them away. Then they're not inalienable. Mm-hmm. So, therefore, the whole concept was that because there was a lawgiver, mm-hmm. we can have law, and a governmental law, or as we spoke a couple days ago, or yesterday, or whatever it was, it can really be law is king. Right. Simply because there's a lawgiver to give the law.
Well, you have to also have some sort of a belief that there is a future punishment for evil or a future reward for good. Doesn't that sort of tie in? Because otherwise, it's lex talionis or eat, drink, and be merry, the philosophy of the Epicurean or whoever, who says that tomorrow we die, so who cares? Let's live it up for today.
Yeah. This is right. We must see that on the materialistic side, that it's absolutely neutral about cruelty or non-cruelty. The final reality would be this. In this case, therefore, there is no absolute to judge anything by, whether it's personal relationships, personal actions, personal lifestyle, or government. In consequence, therefore, the word guilt becomes stupid and meaningless and nonsense if you do not have an absolute to set these things. Now, of course, after that, there comes the other side of it, and that is if there is such a God who is there, and he has a character, and not all things are the same to him, which is the Judeo-Christian God, not the Eastern gods. But if there is such a one, then when the law is broken, there is real moral guilt, mm-hmm. and there will be punishment. So then, of course, we have the coming of Christ and his dying on the cross to take the punishment. On the other hand, we must realize that this God is going to judge. So therefore, it first of all, before God, there is real guilt. But secondly, there is guilt also before law. Mm-hmm. But all you have to do is look at our own country and realize the whole concept of guilt is going. What we have is everybody's just sick, nobody's guilty for anything, and nobody feels responsibility.
And Jung had taught, if it feels good, do it, which is a hedonistic type of creed, whatever is, and that is taught by humanism. If it satisfies you, then do it.
Of course, and that's true in sexual things, but it's not only in sexual things. This is only the most visible. It's in the totality of life.
Well, now, let's go back in history, and also fairly recent history. The French Revolution apparently the crowning of a goddess of reason in one of the Christian churches, Notre Dame, I guess, and then following this expression, this explosion of revolutionary zeal, there was a dictator. Dictatorship, first the terror, then finally Napoleon. Is that...
Absolutely so. Occasionally, people try to parallel the French Revolution and the American Revolution. They're either dishonest or they haven't read their history. The American Revolution was based upon the concept that there was a lawgiver who could give the law. The French Revolution was based on the Enlightenment and man as the center of all things. It led quickly to the rule of terror, in which even the leaders of the revolution were guillotined. The society fell apart so quickly that the French people took their form of authoritarianism with great joy, and that was Napoleon and his rule.
Well, was Nazi Germany a continuation? Would you call that humanistic, or what would you identify Adolf Hitler as?
Well, absolutely. You have a materialistic view, and therefore society, and this brings us to abortion, which is so crucial in all this, therefore human life had no intrinsic value, and the elite, in that case Hitler and his little group, would be able to kill whoever they wished to kill for the good of society. And we've opened the door, humanism has opened the door to that same thing in our country, in abortion and infanticide and all that it leads to.
Has our society been undergoing a subtle and perhaps radical shift from its early moorings? Is there something taking place in our schools, in our society, in our courts, in our government in general, that would take us along the road of humanism, which denies the existence of God, and away from the Judeo-Christian traditions that we've had for so long? And we've been talking with noted Christian philosopher and author and scholar, Dr. Francis Schaeffer, about humanism and its impact on American society, and what you might do about it. First of all, you have to understand the roots of what's going on, and then how you can meet this challenge. And once again, would you please welcome to the 700 Club from La Brie Fellowship in Switzerland, Dr. Francis Schaeffer. Just delighted that we can have this week of chats together. Yesterday we were talking about humanism, and people aren't quite sure, because they think the word humanitarian, that sounds so wonderful, and the humanities are taught in school, and there are various other definitions. Could you make some distinctions between all of these various terms?
Yes, I think that it's very important that we really make the distinctions. Otherwise, first of all, we don't know what we're talking about, but second, we set ourselves up to be shot down, and quite properly. Unless we make the distinctions. Humanitarianism means that we're kind to humanity, and surely then Christians ought to be the most humanitarian people in all the world. Mm-hmm. The humanities would be a study of human creativity, mm-hmm. what the human creativity has produced. Now, sometimes Christians have looked on this sort of negatively, or at least neutrally, but we should be the people of all people who should be interested in the humanities, mm-hmm. because creativity comes from being made in the image of God as the great creator, and consequently of all people, we ought to be interested in the humanities. And so on this basis, the Calvin, for example, or Milton have sometimes been called Christian humanists. Mm-hmm. But that's an old use of the term. But we have to understand we're not against the humanities, we are for them. But humanism, in contrast to that, is quite opposite. Humanism is putting man at the center of all things, and the only knowledge that man can have is what finite human beings can find out for themselves. And absolutely ruled out, dogmatically, the possibility of any knowledge from God. And also means that man is the center of all things in creating all value systems, all the meaning to life, and all the basis for law.
Well, now, when they publish a manifesto is normally a militant document. The Communist Manifesto was a militant document, and they have published two humanist manifestos. Now, is that a militant position that they want to advance to all society?
Absolutely. just as we said yesterday, there is no mixture between these two concepts of final reality. Either material or energy shaped by chance, mm-hmm. or a personal, infinite personal God. Now, there can be no mixture, but they really believe that that's all reality is. And they're out to take their view and put it across. And the thing that should make us ashamed as Christians is that they understood that they were two worldviews that had no mixture, not only intellectually, but they were going to produce absolutely different results in every area of life. And we ought to be ashamed that they understood it before we did.
Well, let me ask you, do you think that Christianity is dominant? Are they dominant? Who's winning in America? They've obviously won in Europe already. Well, what about here in this country?
I would say we're an awful long way down the road. Mm-hmm. Where we are, we must realize that up to, say, 80 years ago, there was an absolute Christian consensus in this country. This country was founded on a Christian consensus, a Judeo-Christian position, especially as it came out of the Reformation, and this was the dominant view. But beginning about 80 years ago, it began to shift. And then all the titanic changes have come in the last 40 years. Mm-hmm. So within the time of our own lifetime, the changes come. Today, we live in a humanist society. They control the schools. They control public television. They control the media in general. And what we have to say is we live in a humanist society. But we're moving very, very rapidly toward a totally humanist society. And if we don't hurry up and do something, we're really in trouble.
Well, let's go. One of the things that I hear so often is the question of separation of church and state. They say, well, we're supposed to separate church and state, the humanists don't mean by that what our founding fathers, of course they didn't use that in the Constitution, but the thinking of today is vastly different from what our founding fathers thought.
Absolutely contrary to it. The First Amendment only meant two things and nothing else, and that is that they would not have a national church, mm-hmm. Like the Church of England or the Church of Sweden. They were opposed to the concept of a church for the 13 colonies. The second thing is, now listen, because exactly contrary to what's being made, the state would not interfere with religion. Now that's all the First Amendment meant. Mm-hmm. And today it's been turned over and made the absolute opposite, so that what it's now is that the state is interfering with religion in the very opposite thing. And mm-hmm. now, notice I'm saying religion, all not right. Christianity, that religion now is ruled out of any real impact in our thinking. And the craziness of this shows itself that from the very first, they had somebody pray in Congress. Congress isn't open until it's open
prayer.
With prayer.
That's correct.
So they still could keep doing it. Mm-hmm. But you can't pray in public schools.
Yes.
How schizophrenic can you get?
Well, it's the same thing with the Supreme Court, which says, God bless this noble court. I mean, it starts out that way, and yet they deny the privilege of little children to do what they do and to post the Ten Commandments, which they have on the walls of their court.
And I would want to say with all finality that if the Founding Fathers could come back and see what's being made of that First Amendment, mm-hmm. they would consider it nothing less than tyranny.
Well, let's go back to the concept of law. If you have a Christian state, what is law? If you have a humanist state, what is law?
Well, if you have a Christian state, or let's not say a Christian state, but a state that's founded on a Christian consensus. Mm-hmm. If you have this, you have a basis for law. And you must remember that what we have out of the Northern European culture of form and freedom, of balances in government, these things are absolutely unique in the world. They were unique in history. Sometimes people say the Greek city-states have them. No real scholar believes this. What the Reformation produced was absolutely unique, in which there was real form, and yet the Christian consensus mm-hmm. kept the freedoms from pounding the society to pieces, because there's a law to base things on. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, if you come in from the humanist side, man is the measure of all things, and there's nothing to found it on. So that it's very interesting that these people move from denying the building of law upon the Word of God mm-hmm. to denying any strict construction from the Constitution. They're absolutely They're absolutely free to make law what they want it to be.
So the concept of law as existing apart, in a sense, from man, but coming from God and being a discovery of revelation of God, that's where we started. The idea of law is king, lex rex, that is the king. And now we're substituting men's views, sociological interpretation for law.
We switched it right over.
Yeah.
Samuel Rutherford, who means a great deal to me, wrote his lex rex. Law is king. And what he was saying is the king is not law. Mm-hmm. Now, what we've turned it is we flipped it right over from Oliver Wendell Holmes. All these people have brought in sociological law, mm-hmm. which means that law is made on what a few people think is for the sociological good of the mm-hmm. Community at the moment. We flipped it right over, and now what we're returning to, people don't think of it this way, is rex, lex. King is law. The only thing is we don't have a king. What we have is a Supreme Court, or we have 51% vote, or we have what the technocrats come forward and tell us is for the good of society. So what we've done is flipped it right over from lex, rex, now rex, lex.
Well, you think the Supreme Court is the vehicle that the humanists are using, or the court system, to effectuate a radical change in society?
Well, government as a whole, but especially the courts, and there's a reason for this. All the humanists and this type of thinker have used the courts rather than the legislatures, mm-hmm. for the simple reason the courts are not subject to the will of the people through election or re-election. Consequently, all the great changes in the last 40 years has come through the courts. And what we must get in our mind is the government as a whole, but especially the courts, has become the vehicle mm-hmm. to force this view on the total population, even if the total population doesn't hold the view.
We have a right to revolt against that. We're going to talk about that later in these discussions. But there comes a time that you have a right to revolt against tyranny, don't you?
If you don't revolt against tyranny, and this is what I call the bottom line, mm-hmm. is that not only do you have the privilege, but the duty to revolt when people force upon you and society that which is absolutely contrary to the Word of God mm-hmm. and which really is tyranny. So Samuel Rutherford was an amazing fellow, and what he pointed out quite properly is that God is never the author of tyranny. Therefore, wherever tyranny arises, we have a right to stand against it as a matter of principle. And this was the basis upon which the founding fathers built this country.
We're told to obey the civil authorities. The Christians were told by Paul to obey those in authority, and yet they wouldn't obey that point which said you must worship the emperor as God. What about us today?
Well, we must realize that the humanist that we've been talking about, the one holding the materialistic view of final reality, those who hold this view, and that's most of the youngsters now down into the universities, mm-hmm. they have no reason for obeying the state except the state has the guns mm-hmm. and they can give out things to the people. That's all. They have no reason any more than they have for sexual values or any other values. The Christian, on the other hand, is told to obey the state, so we have a reason for obeying the state. And the state is one of the offices given by God to restrain this fallen, abnormal world from going to chaos. But, now we come strongly to the but that does not mean that God has set up an autonomous authority, autonomous to himself, and his commands. It is not as though the government is the one place where man is meant to be the measure of all things. Now this meant in the early church, just what we just saw, that when Caesar said he was to be worshipped, you must realize from the Christian's viewpoint it was religious. From the state's viewpoint it had nothing to do with religion at all. You could be an atheist, you could worship anything, Zoroastrianism, anything. They didn't care. It had nothing to do with religion. It was purely civil. So when those Christians said we refuse to worship Caesar and they were thrown into the Roman arena, they were in civil disobedience. They were the rebels. Mm-hmm. Now we have to get that into our mind. The same thing is true when we come to the Reformation. There was no place where the Reformation was successful without some form of civil disobedience and often something stronger. Consequently, we must face the question. The bottom line, the bottom line is simply this, and that is that there comes a place where the state whether it's a communistic state or our own state, no matter what it is, the state commands that which is contrary to the law of God. The Christian not only has the privilege, he has the absolute duty to disobey the state. And if we do not face that bottom line, we must recognize where we are. We have said, contrary to what the early Christians said, we have said that the state is God. In other words, there's no middle ground on this one. Mm-hmm. None whatsoever. Either the state is going to be made God, a false God, but God, mm-hmm. and we're going to obey it no matter what, or we must face the factor that there are certain places we come to where the state must be disobeyed.
Well, now, back to the revolution. Our forefathers had a not too arbitrary king. He was claimed to be a madman, but he wasn't as near as bad as communists are today, mm-hmm. King George. And there was a parliament, and parliament put some taxes on the people. They weren't terribly burdensome taxes. There were stamp taxes on certain exports and imports and so forth. Nothing that we would consider in relation to our current internal revenue tax. It wasn't even, it was a fraction of what we have to pay now. And yet, they decided that that was cause enough to rebel, or to have a revolution. Now, and they, of course, they quartered troops, they did other things that were obnoxious to the people.
What we must realize is, just as the Wall Street Journal that I quoted before pointed out, that it was the Great Awakening that got people ready for this. And as I stress and document very carefully in the book, The Christian Manifesto, the Christian clergy had a great deal to do with all this. And no greater name than Witherspoon. Witherspoon was a great hero of mine. He's president of what is now Princeton University. And he was the only signer of the Declaration of Independence. And he followed directly after Samuel Rutherford and his writing Lex Rex. And whether you held the view that Witherspoon did, or even those who weren't Christian individually, nevertheless, they all saw, they all had the view that when you came to tyranny, mm-hmm. that you had to oppose it. And the Christians, the Christian clergy, the real Bible-believing Christians, not the deists, no. The real Bible-believing Christians were very much rooted back into that concept where the early church stood. And that is that as Christians, they had a responsibility to stand against what they saw as tyranny. And they had it was back into Samuel Rutherford again, and then behind that into John Knox. And that is that all tyranny comes from the devil and not from God, because God wants free people to be free and not to be held with any form of tyranny. Now, you mentioned about our present laws, our present taxes, and so forth. What we're facing in this country today is far beyond what they were facing.
Oh, absolutely.
And if they thought they had to stand against tyranny, we better stand against tyranny. And we have tyranny. We have a hidden censorship. We showed this from whatever happened to the human race. It's technically a good film.
Yes.
Everybody acknowledges this. So we offered it to public television. But the woman who saw it, the director in Washington, as soon as she heard it was against abortion, she said, we can't show this because we can only show things on shows both sides. So she wouldn't even look at it. Mm-hmm. But simultaneously, they were showing this abominable Hard Choices, which is sheer propaganda in favor of abortion.
Mm-hmm.
Public television, I think, is a clear viewpoint, a clear illustration of a hidden censorship. You have Cosmos. You have Bernowski's The Ascent of Man. You have Clark's Civilization. You have a new series coming on right now at this present time on evolution. All these things carried along with public tax money. But we cannot get our things on. We must get this fixes another thought in our mind. Humanism, this materialist view, intrinsically is oppressive and it's exclusive. And the proof of it is the public schools. They take over the public schools, and they will not allow, the civil liberties union lawyers and the other people will not allow another voice. Mm-hmm. And they absolutely use a perverted view of the First Amendment in order, now this one really should bring us up short. The schools in the United States today are as secularized, they aren't Marxist, but they're as secularized as the schools in Russia. The schools in Russia allow only the materialistic view to be taught.
Mm-hmm.
But in the United States, the public schools today, paid for by the parents' tax money,
That's right.
are as exclusively teaching the materialistic view as are the schools in Russia. And even if the parents, as in Arkansas and Louisiana and these other places, even if the parents don't want it taught, the courts are the vehicle to say, you children have to be taught exclusively the materialistic view, whether you like it or not.
Well, that, of course, is oppressive. It is tyrannical. It's exactly what Thomas Jefferson spoke against. Now, what do we do? The window, in a sense, may be open, but the tyranny's coming down. What should Christians do? And this is happening.
We must operate on what Samuel Rutherford would have called the appropriate level. You don't start from the top and use the biggest thing. You start where you can. We are fortunate to be one of the very few countries left in the 150-some countries in the world that have freedom. We should use every political means. That means electing people who will carry out these views and at least be for freedom. That's all we ask. We don't ask that our view would have preeminence. We're asking for freedom, the very thing our founding fathers were willing to die for. Then we ought to carry on. And if in the courts, we ought to have a good Christian lawyers like John Whitehead and so on, carry these things right up into the Supreme Court and challenge all these things, because they're quite opposed, really, to the legal
Absolutely.
Continuity out of the past. Then beyond that, we must be willing to disobey. And it's up to the individual Christian. Nobody else should tell another person. But there would be a place to stop paying part of your taxes in these areas, because of these areas. There would also be a place to picket. Mm-hmm. There is a place to do all these things. There's a place, perhaps, to have a sit-in in the Supreme Court. In other words, we should work on the appropriate level, but using the freedoms we have, we're not carrying out either our God-given command, mm-hmm. nor even what our founding fathers would have considered the proper attitude toward tyranny. We're not carrying out either one unless we use the appropriate means at the present time to reverse the direction we're going in.